Good morning, Western Massachusetts. Good morning, beautiful people. It is Friday, April 16th, 2021, episode 27 of 413 Sports Talk starts now. Happy Friday. I call this Football Friday, as you know. So we have Western Mass sports scores and a preview of all things Western Mass football that's going to go on today and Saturday. We also have scores from the NBA, the MLB, and the NHL. So, and also, another treat I have for you guys, I'm sorry, before we continue, how rude of me, are another NFL draft special of the top 10 offensive linemen. So without further ado, here we go. We are first going to jump into the NBA. The Milwaukee Bucks beat the Atlanta Hawks 120-109. Golden State tops the Cleveland Cavaliers 119-109. Boston Celtics beat my Los Angeles Lakers 121-113. And the nightcap, the Phoenix Suns beat the Sacramento Kings by a score of 122-114. Moving on to the National Hockey League, Boston Bruins beat the Islanders 4-1. Rangers over the Devils 4-0. Buffalo beats Washington 3-2. Carolina over Nashville 4-1. In overtime, Tampa Bay beat Florida 3-2. Philly beats Pittsburgh 2-1. Winnipeg over Toronto 5-2. Detroit Red Wings beat the Chicago Blackhawks 4-1. And Columbia loses to Dallas 4-1. And those are your NHL scores. Moving on to the Major League Baseball, the Atlanta Braves beat the Miami Marlins in a very, very close game, and one that I watched, 7-6. The San Diego Padres beat the Pittsburgh Pirates 8-3. Today is Friday, which means the San Diego Padres have a chance to get back Fernando Tatis Jr., one of the MLB's rising stars, has a chance to come back today, and that's gonna be something significant, even though that team's been performing since he's been out. You know, Joe Musgrove threw the team's first no-hitter last week. So the Padres have really been rising. The last couple years, they've been you know, gathering those first-round picks, and guys on the farm team have been producing. So it's been awesome. Because the San Diego Padres, to my knowledge, have never been a winning baseball team. So, shout out to the San Diego Padres. I'm glad that you guys are succeeding. We will go on to our doubleheader, the Seattle Mariners and the Baltimore Orioles. Seattle won the first game 4-2, as well as the second one by a score of 2-1. Minnesota Twins beat the Boston Red Sox 4-3. Cleveland over the Chicago White Sox 4-2. The Philadelphia Phillies and New York Mets game was postponed due to rain. Arizona smokes the Washington Nationals 11-6. We have Texas over Tampa Bay 6-4. And the Kansas City Royals over Toronto Blue Jays 7-5. And some other news real quick before we get on to the NFL draft special. Chicago Bulls star Zach LaVine is likely to miss multiple games. As you know, yesterday he was placed under the coronavirus protocol. So results on that test will come back today and confirm if he's positive. And from what I read on ESPN, there was contact tracing was done, and he potentially was exposed to somebody with the virus. So yeah, I pray for him and hope that his test comes negative and that nobody, whoever he was around, is safe as well, most definitely. Brooklyn Nets forward LaMarcus Aldridge announced his retirement amid a health scare. He's got some issues with his heart. LaMarcus Aldridge, I always thought, was a great forward. Really big guy. He really make you pay down low. He just was never really an all-star. He's just a guy known around the league, but not by any means an all-star. But regardless to what, I pray and I hope the best for you, LaMarcus Aldridge, and your family, and whatever venture you decide to get into. Once your health is taken care of, that's key. Michael Jordan is to serve as Kobe Bryant's presenter for the enshrinement in this for this year's enshrinement in the Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame, located here in Springfield, Massachusetts. That's going to be big. I remember the last time MJ came to Springfield. It was in 2007, I believe, the year I graduated high school. So everybody was downtown that month, and MJ came, and I didn't get a chance to see him, obviously. I was trying to, but he'll be back in Springfield to be the presenter for Kobe Bryant, and this time we'll make an attempt at going to see him. The WNBA draft happened yesterday. Charlie Collier from Texas goes number one overall to the Dallas Wings. Dallas Wings have not been successful of late. Another team that I kind of liken to the Detroit Lions, if you kind of get the comedy there, with their success. Collier is a great player. She switches between two and three. She's really, really the powerhouse of that Texas half-court offense. So she gets to go to Dallas as the number one overall pick and start her career. And I am more than happy for her. More than happy for her. Moving on to the NFL draft special, the top 10 offensive line. No matter what franchise you root for, go Pack, go. You need a great offensive line. Specifically, you need anchors on the left or right side. The anchors are what I like to call the offensive tackles. That's a form of their technique, anchor, but I consider the anchors of the offensive line the tackles on either side, the guys that protect the quarterback from those pass rushers. So here we go with my top 10 list and a fact or two about each one. You know, there's only so many type of offensive linemen, so as far as comparing them and evaluating them, it's not really too many differences between them. But here we go. A quick list of 10 top offensive tackles that I saw in this upcoming draft. Is there anybody on this list that you think should have made it? Let me know, and we will do some adjustments. But without further ado, Brady Christensen, the left tackle out of BYU. He protected Zach Wilson, and he did it very well. At 6'6", 300 pounds, I predict him to go between the second and third round. He needs to polish up a little bit on his technique, and I think the way he distributes his weight helps in his pass protection. He's a very, very top-heavy guy, very muscular. And I think that's where his body strength resides. And I think that's why Brady Christensen's going to be a good offensive tackle at the next level. And he just needs to polish up on his all-around technique. But he's a great guy, definitely a franchise piece to build around. Had he came out the draft last year, he definitely would have been a first-round pick. But he decided to stay and continue to protect Zach Wilson. And it's paid dividends. I have him rated number 10. A lot of guys have him going earlier than the second and third round. But there's my evaluation on Brady Christensen. Number 9, one of my favorite tackles on this list, Walker Little, the left tackle for the Stanford Cardinals. I have him going in the second round. 6'7", 309 pounds. The thing about Walker Little is that he had an ACL injury that derailed his junior season, and his senior season he opted out due to the COVID-19 pandemic, and used this year to prepare, get ready for the draft, show franchises that he is the guy that he was before he tore his ACL. So it's going to be interesting to see where Walker Little goes, somewhere in the second round. But whoever gets him is probably going to get a steal as long as he stays healthy. Number 8. This is a guy a lot of people mock going in the first round. He is the Michigan Wolverine, 6'5", 220 pounds, Jalen Mayfield. He's one of the best run supporting offensive linemen I've ever seen. When he's off the ball, it's quick. He gets at it. He gets nasty. That punch move is something other than I've ever seen. And he's just really ferocious. Jalen Mayfield, to me, is not the best athlete. And with poor short bursts of speed, I think faster defensive ends can use what they got in their tool belt to get around him. So it'll be interesting to see what Jalen Mayfield does at the next level and if he's properly coached in order to elevated skills. Number 7, I got Dylan Radunes from North Dakota State University. And I just talked with New England University offensive line coach Bobby Johnson about Dylan Radunes last night as I rewatched North Dakota State's only game that they played in 2020, which Trey Lance shined. But Trey Lance shined because of Dylan Radunes and the protection that he brings. He had a great Senior Bowl, which obviously lifted up his stock, got a couple extra teams looking at him. He has great technique. I love the way he uses his body and his pliability and flexibility. But the question with Dylan Radunes has been the competition he's played. Schools like Boise State, North Dakota State, they don't really play like SEC teams, Big 12 teams. So a lot can be said about their competition. And that would truly define who's a good player, what grade he gets, and what round he goes in. So, as I said, Dylan Radunes from North Dakota State, I don't have too many knocks on him, and he's going to go in the second round. Moving on to my number six guy I have coming out of Notre Dame. A lot of great players coming out of Notre Dame this season and this draft, which I've alluded to in other episodes, but we'll touch on again at the end of this. Liam Eichenberg, 6'6", 308. He's either a first-round or a second-round guy. Positional flexibility and great technique. I like his jump set and the off-ball quickness. I think Liam Eichenberg is a first-round guy, but he could go in the first or second because the rest of the guys I have on this list are considerably better and have played for programs that had better competition. So there's always that piece that you have to think when evaluating. Think about when you have to when evaluating offensive linemen, their competition, school they played for, and their overall health and those pancake blocks. So Liam Eichenberg, he's going in the first or second rounds. To who, I don't know. I have him in the draft before I'm doing now. I have him mocked actually in the third round, but evaluating him a little bit yesterday changed my mind. Moving on to number five, this guy is the most violent man in college football, in my opinion. I love all his technique. He is the best arms, the best use of that grip that you love in offensive linemen. He goes by the name of Tevin Jenkins, 6'6", 315 pounds, from Oklahoma State University. I love the way he plays. He's a badass, especially in the run game. Other than Jalen Mayfield, he's probably the other best run supporting offensive lineman I have on this evaluation. It's gonna be interesting to see where he goes. Wherever he goes, definitely gets a guy who is capable of starting in day one. Number four, Samuel Cosmi from the Texas Longhorns, 6'7", 309 pounds. He's a franchise piece at right tackle. He could play either side, right or left. I think he's great pass protection, run protection. If there's a comp, I would say Brian Bulaga is a former Packer. He was really a great at Iowa when he was in college. But yeah, you would compare him to Brian Bulaga with the aggressiveness, the off-ball speed. Samuel Cosmi and some other mocks, people had him going top 15. I don't think he's that. I think that's a little too rich, but we'll see. This is the NFL. Christian Darrisaw is my number three offensive lineman from Virginia Tech. He's 6'5", 314. He's going in the first round, probably in the later half, picks 21 to 32. He's an elite left tackle. He's definitely a franchise piece, as I consider him. He loves to get out there and run and hit guys. And many a times I've seen him push guys out of the play. Ridiculous. Snap after snap after snap. He's a good guy that loves getting to the second level and hitting those defenders. Number two and number one is a matter of preference, though I have some new opinions on Rashawn Slater, 6'3", 309, out of Northwestern. He has some of the best upside out of all the offensive tackles. I like his technique. I like the fact that he's very explosive. I just don't like his size. He's a little smaller for a tackle, and skilled defensive ends can get around him. Rashawn Slater is going to go in the first round, most likely in top 10. Most likely in the top 10. People are mocking him to go to Dallas. Not sure. Could go to Cincinnati if they don't go with my number one guy in Penei Sewell. 6'6", 325. He is the top offensive tackle in this draft. I think Christian Darrisaw might have could have gotten in this place too, but he didn't really have too much of a senior season. So Penei Sewell from Oregon is the number one offensive lineman that I have rated, offensive tackle that I have rated. The only knock on Penei Sewell is the way the off-ball speed's a little slow, but stuff like that can be changed with great coaching. So, moving on to the final notch in our episode, we have Western Mass Sports. Let's get into the scores before we get into Football Friday, because that's the biggest part of our show today. Girls Volleyball, Central beats Renaissance 3-1, Turner's Falls over Mayhar 3-0, and South Hadley beats Southwick 3-0. In girls basketball, Belchertown beats Gateway 41-13. Boys basketball, Sabas beats Holyoke 47-36, while Hampshire ends up beating Northampton 82-75. Congratulations to Mr. Justin Forrest, who in the Hampshire and Northampton game ended up scoring his 1,000th point. That is no small feat, and us at 413 Sports Talk would like to congratulate you, Mr. Justin Forrest. Thank you for entertaining Hampshire high school basketball fans with your scoring, your moves, and now here you are with 1,000 points. Moving on to the high school football preview. It's Football Friday, everybody. Rejoice. We have on your slate of games today, Greenfield going to Athol, West Springfield, and what many have said is the game of the week, go to Amherst to square off with them. East Hampton and Ludlow. Agawam goes to play Westfield, and one of my favorite players in Western Mass Sports, Will Brewster, gets a chance to suit up and show his moves over there at wide receiver. Rivalry game with Longmeadow going to play East Longmeadow, and finishing off the Friday games is Mayhar at Franklin Tech. Saturday, we have a big game. Central and Minichog take two. Central plays the Minichog Falcons this Saturday. Time to be announced. I will get that to you as soon as I know. Also, football Saturday, we have Northampton and Ware, and Chicopee plays Putnam. The high school football power rankings, really quickly, are as follows. Central at the number one spot with a 1-0 record. They get ready to play Minichog tomorrow. South Hadley's 3-0 at number two. Minichog is third at 3-1. Longmeadow is in fourth place at 3-1 as well, and we have Ware at 3-1 rounding out the fifth place. Greenfield comes at number six at 2-0. The West Springfield Terriers are 2-0 as well. They're my seventh ranked team. Athol is 2-0 as well. They come in at number eight. Northampton at number nine, and the final team on my top 10 high school football power rankings are the Holyoke Knights, Scarlet Knights of Holyoke. And notable mentions, we have East Hampton ranked 11th and Agawam ranked 12th. Agawam's got a big game against Westfield today. Can't wait to see what's going to happen with that. If I'm Westfield and you guys are listening, pass. That secondary is a bit suspect. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. This has been another episode of 413 Sports Talk, episode 27 to be exact. Please, as always, like, share, subscribe, comment. We're on YouTube as well. And if there was a fact in this episode that I got wrong, and my evaluation on a player wasn't good, or if there was something that you felt I should have added, please leave a comment or message me, and I will get back to you. Thank you, all you beautiful and lovely people. Enjoy your Friday. Enjoy these high school football games that start this afternoon. And, of course, love each other and have a great day.